Greetings, Solid Roc family. You're now tuning in to Solid Roc Entertainment with your host and essential co-host Samuel Gardner. Today's guest, we have a special guest, and as I'd like to say, all of our guests are special. And this artist is the present and the future of the dance, one of the present and the future of the dance hall. And this is none other than Anthony Clark, and who he is and well known as is Devin Di Dakta. Devin Di Dakta, it's an honor having you on the show, man. All right, and I am that, Mr. Ribangi Deng. We don't even know what to say it.
Same way, sir.
All right.
We're
gonna jump right into it and get into the mind of Devin. So, Devin, first, I wanna say, congrats on the latest the Grammy nomination you just received.
And,
you know, you're doing a good job, man. And I'm just saying you're doing a good thing for Jamaica, brother.
Yeah.
So based on my research, I've learned that you had an interest in being in the medical field.
Right? Yeah, that was when I was younger. When I was like in sixth grade, at that time I wanted to become a pediatrician. After that, until like ninth grade before I really take music really serious. As well, I was just in here, had a lot of performing for schoolmates. And then even in the community, started like the parish champion. So, from that, I really took it serious and the artist thing there. So, from that music, I'm not turning back.
So basically, I would take it that's the reason that explains why you even call yourself Devin Di Dakta.
Yeah, because Devin is my nickname. That's what most people know me as.
Oh, okay, that explains it. Okay, so what gave you the confidence to head into the direction of music and put the medical thing to the side?
Music was always my first love, but not as a career.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everyone knew me from when I was younger. I'm an artist, used to DJ in the community at birthday parties and such. As I said, performance in the school, then I realized that I see no problem in me becoming an artist. You know, a lot of successful artists are out there. At first, a lot of teachers especially never really accepted it because they were like, you're just well in school and you really want to throw away your dream as a pediatrician to become an artist. But at the end of the day, it's what me love, you know, so.
That's true. That's true. At the end of the day, you can't force a man to do it. It is what you want to do, like you say, you know? Your passion. Okay, now, you became more popular and more famous when you're heading to the televised music competition, Magnum King and Queens, correct?
Yeah.
But where?
Even before that, when I was like in the first part of 11th grade, that was 2012, I won Taste Challenge Real as well.
Okay.
From that time.
Okay. You was in the Tasties competition?
Yeah, I won that competition when I was 16.
Okay, man. So you're destined for this from a long time, brother?
Yeah, man. It's a long time. And then even after that, I used to travel to Kingston to a clash. Popcorn, everybody knows Popcorn. They used to keep a thing called Unruly Clash Wednesday.
Yes.
So every Wednesday, I used to left from St. Mary and go Kingston, got clash. And I never laughed. Never ever. When I do fight in everything. So I was like the Clash champion. Yeah, and then after that now Magnum King and Queen. Yeah.
Well, I think that explains it now, because observing you and Magnum King and Queen, based on your performance and your delivery and your comfort on stage, it's like I could already see that you're already seasoned.
Yeah.
Okay, so you did have previous experience before that one.
Yeah, man, I always did a Clash. Like, Clash was my first love, before I really start write music, as in songs for listeners, I used to just love clashing. I love competition, you know. Oh. Yeah, man, I'm very strong competitor in whatever I do, so. I'm always like Clash. Even when a new artist entered the school, St. Mary High School,
Once
more
to
the DJ name of a past
two days in
the
doctor,
that's how
you've learned it. True, brother, true. So, all right, we I don't want to stray too far from the music, but you said that you're from St. Mary.
Yeah.
How was life growing up in the countryside?
Countryside is where my heart is, even while I'm in Kingston. I always love country. So country, you know, you grow up more bush. You know, at that time, you know, we have to run up and down in a bush. We climb the tallest tree, then we catch with guinea, the mango, the apple, you know, all of them things. That we have a boat toilet, we have to fall them.
Oh, yeah, so.
I always have like about 200 chickens, 400 chickens. We have woolly bug goat, we have rabbit.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, so.
So you know if you survive, Devin?
Huh?
You know if you survive?
Yeah, man, definitely, man.
Okay. All right, brother. All right, so back to the music now. All right, so when he was on the televised competition there, Magnum Kings and Queen, who would you consider was, in your opinion now, who you would consider to be a slight of a challenge, let's so to speak?
I'm Lava Vain.
Lava Vain?
Yeah, Lava Vain. He was, me and him went to the final.
Okay.
Yeah, so that guy is wicked, man. I'm a brother, so.
So he kind of made you, go back to the drawing board?
Yeah, because as I said, we knew him inside out. Like, we are from St. Mary, so I knew his potential, you know, what he's capable of. So when a lot of people wanted me to clash someone else, mm-hmm. me don't know, sir. I got the Lava Vain, because nobody with them wants me clashing a bad like Lava Vain, so. Yeah, I mean, they don't predict it, and we didn't know that, right? Because I'm going at the drawing book, catch up the thing there, and just get him down for the final night.
Yeah, man, you do your thing for the night, I tell you. No respect to Lava Vain anyway, you know? In your own words, Devin, when you realize that things are getting serious with your career, being a winning, you know, after being a winning contestant for Magnum, King and Queen, and offers from various labels, how ready were you for the next step?
I'm always ready, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just up to good music and always I prepare myself for the highest. And no one can tell you that I'm not the type to celebrate. So even when, no matter how something big happened for Devin Di Dakta and the whole world, I celebrate as a youth. I'm always the type to sit down mm-hmm. and think about my move.
Good, good, good.
Yes, I'm not going to make all of the hype and things catch up in my brain and say, oh, you reached, no. So anything come or something, I mean, I really got prepared for from when I was young, but I think when I'm at one step and success comes, mm-hmm. instead of celebrate, I stay by myself and prepare for the next level.
Mm. Well,
yeah, so that's basically the Devin Di Dakta.
Well, I think you're telling the truth on that, because when I observe you in the videos and so forth, I mean, even when in previous interviews prior to this, you seem to be an observer.
Yeah, very much.
Yeah, you're not too much really talking, but you observe and gravitate to what I go on. Yeah. Okay. Well, you being an artist, please explain how important it is to songwrite and also connect with your audience.
I mean, connection with the audience is the key thing. You cannot perform on a stage, but you cannot really grab the attention of the people. Remember, the people are who buy the music.
Right.
So if you're connecting with them, and it's still like a boil down back to how you structure your song. For example, you're writing your song. Well, for me personally, I'm not going to say about everybody, but for me personally, when I'm writing my song, mm-hmm. before me even record it, I practice and edit it and imagine myself on a stage and see how am I gonna perform that song to grab the audience.
Right.
So certain words I would use, certain words I would not use.
Mm.
Every time I write a song, mm-hmm. basically I'm writing my performance. Could say that. I write a song and think about how will I perform that song.
Smart, okay.
Yes.
Okay. So now showtime.
That's the reason why I'm so strong on stage. Anyone can tell you that when I'm on a stage, I'm very commanding. People always love living the doctor shows.
Well, I'm going to say this. When I watch on Magnum King and Queens, I will say that you put me in the mind of a Beanie Man.
Yeah, a lot of people say that.
You know, yeah, as far and as you're
one of the heroes in my performance. As a young youth, I'm always watching veterans perform, because they're not the young people nowadays. They're not really perform good, so I'm like, I can watch a young youth perform and grab something from them. So I'm always As I said, if you don't know the history, you don't know where you go.
Right.
So I always want to know who was there before me, what have they done. And I feel like, for example, Beanie Man was the greatest, he's still one of the greatest on the stage. So I'm always watching Beanie Man's performance, not imitate, but emulate.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Right.
That's one thing with.
Go ahead.
Yeah, and the other from other genres, like even Michael Jackson, them. You know, there are some great people. From Soca side, like Mr. Killer, those type of people.
Okay.
Much for a lot of different people perform and just grasp from their performance, incorporated with my thing, my own style.
Most definitely. You know, put yourself in a box. You open up your mind and dibble and dabble in different genres.
Yeah, man, not all the time.
Okay. Well, speaking of experimenting with sound, my next question. Now, no doubt, you have songs like the first one, like, excuse me, I don't know if I pronounce it, but the first song, the Ribang Bidang Deng Deng.
Yeah,
all right. May I forget my DJ skill up. But as far as that song, that was a big hit. You had a music video for that and everything. But the song that caught my attention, and me being once a songwriter and a little bit of an artist in my previous time, I listened to the track a few years back that's called Forevermore, right?
Yeah.
And I
said, to be honest, that's like one of my biggest songs, even bigger than Ruben Bideng, but a lot of people locally don't really know that, but in like Africa side.
Yes.
That song is huge in Zimbabwe, huge in Gambia, Ghana, those places.
Yeah, man, trust me, this is what I'm saying now about this.
And that's like one of my favorite songs for myself personally.
Boy, Devin, I tell you, when I listen to that song, and because I had it on my phone, and I said to myself, Devin, I take this thing to another level as far as the penmanship and the melodies.
Yeah.
So I said, so I'm going to ask you, was it the rhythm that gave you the drive to do the song the way you did it?
Yeah, well, we did that song right in the studio, you know, like, I was at Big Yard Studio, you know, Robert Livingston,
Yes. Previous
manager of Chaggy, Supercap, all those people done. I was like in the studio, and Sanjay of Magnum, King and King, he's like the producer of it. Mm-hmm. I was doing an interview called Intent.
Yes.
Then after now, Mr. Robert Livingston walk out, I knew his name, because as I said before, I was always doing my research on the great stuff in the picture.
Right.
I knew the name, but I never knew the person.
Okay.
And then I was sitting to meet him at the same time and say, yo. And he heard a song that I did and he said, you do reggae? And I said, me do anything once the rhythm nice. And then we're going to do the same time and play the rhythm. I'm listening to rhythm a few times and then just start right.
Mm.
And that was the outcome
for more. I'm telling you, man.
Yeah.
that song terrible, man. That song there is a real, is a great transition for a dancehall artist such as yourself. And we can say, you know, for versatile and just bring it over into reggae. You know,
yeah,
man, that was a good move, man. And it has helped, yeah. That song has helped you for be on a more wider scale, bigger than Jamaica, so.
Bigger than Jamaica by far, because in Jamaica it play like on the radio.
Okay.
It got a lot of radio support, like, because you know, like Robert Livingston is well known. So when he sent out a song, especially the radio, Radio Lam will gravitate to it quick.
Most
like in the, you know, a lot of people, especially Jamaica now, they love the more jump up song, but people will listen to music, as I said before, like in Africa, Europe, those places.
Mm-hmm.
That song is a really big song, like, in those places, man.
Yeah, man, a big tune, nonetheless. So, all right, being a dancehall artist in this era, do you think albums are still necessary to be made?
Well, for me personally, yes, it is. I believe in catalog. I don't believe in one song and then you know have a next song after that.
Mm-hmm.
I believe in catalog, and I think album is a good way to showcase versatility, especially. Mm-hmm. You can have an album and every song sound the same, and nobody really want to hear that. But once you have an album, you show a little versatility on it. You know, different writing skills on the same album. I mean, people are going to love it, and that will help your catalog when you perform your song. Them people can say, no, I think we can sing that song. And look at my thing. Like, for example, like you said, reggae, Forevermore, and the song called Ribbon Bitten Deng. Two different songs. I imagine both of those on album.
True.
I would be pleasing the dancehall and the reggae fans on one album. So I think album is necessary.
Okay. And if you ever do make an album in the future, I think you should put some, if it's not Forevermore, something in that direction on the album. Because it's album material.
Yeah, it's the album I got nominated for, it's a reggae album.
Yeah.
It's a reggae for her, it's a reggae album. And even the dancehall tracks on that album have a more international, it has a crossover sound. Because I'm always speaking international, you know, so the most of my work, especially to date, those are
the international stuff that people can really look at. That's the way to go, because, I mean, as we already know, I mean, the gun lyrics and all them things don't really go further too far. So
then there's just lunch money, get a duct tape, and that's it. People, especially the really want, nobody don't want to hear them. They now push not. Now remember, reggae music is known for teaching and uplifting people.
Exactly, bro. Exactly.
Yes, so we use it right. A lot of great things can happen from it, yeah. I'm always aiming international, even if our EP completed, called I Am Ed Coffrey.
Mm-hmm.
All songs on that are aiming international. I have a song on it called Beautiful. I did that song on Bob Marley's birthday show the other day in Kingston, and everybody asked for that song. And I said, no, they can't get it, they just wait for the album. Well, it's an EP, really.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have something to wait for, too.
Yeah, so that song is especially beautiful, and the one called Let Loose.
Yeah.
Trust me, smashing song. The album is called, well, the EP I should say is called I Am Ed Coffrey, and it's a solo project. The one before was a collaboration with me and JL, so this one, my debut solo project. So it's going to be really awesome. As I said, real international, but it's a more fusion mix of like dance with EDM, with trap. But that's really the direction I'm taking that album.
Okay, so it's going to have an international vibe.
Yeah, I mean, start to finish.
Okay, all right. I'm looking forward for that.
Yeah, man, definitely. It's really something to look out for.
So currently, you're being managed by John John Music Group, right? Correct?
Yeah, Shelly and Curran, yeah. John John Music Group, yeah.
Yeah, Shelly and Curran. So far, how has that helped your career?
Like the best, I don't think I could get a better manager. You know, without a manager, artist is basically nothing.
Exactly.
An artist needs a manager, especially in time like this. You know, personal times, artists, if you check it out, artists who try to focus on management always end up flop. To me, artists must only focus on the creative aspect of the music.
Right.
Leave the business partners to business partners. And Shelly and Cora now, been in marketing over the years. She used to work for digital, and so she's experiencing that deal. I am not. So it's best to have a person like Shelly and Cora. Before I even entered music professionally, I always wanted a female manager, and it so happened that I met Shelly and Cora right after Magnum King and Queen, and it just happened.
Well, they always say, don't put it out where you can't reach it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, man. So if you know, I asked Delando this question, and I'm gonna ask you too. If you can use one word to describe Shelly Ann, what would it be?
One word: dedicated.
Wow, you said the same thing.
Dedicated. When Shelly said, "Devin, I'm sure I'll do something. Believe me, if she can make the rain stop, she has to stop the rain."
Wow.
And if I'm great, I don't want the sun to shine. She'll make sure the sun shines. And she'll not stop until it shines in her night. But that's definitely and Grant dedicated 120%.
Yeah. Yeah, man.
Yeah.
All right. No, enough respect, Shelly, on that. Enough respect, man. We do need people like that in the industry, and especially for the youth them that's coming up. We do need someone that's supportive, you know?
We need someone who will support the youth for the youth and not just for the money. I go manage a young youth, for example, a youth like me, you know, them see the potential and know, so, oh, that youth, they can make a bag of money around here. So that would be the reason why they want to manage me.
Right, right.
You know, we need people like Shelly who is in it to win it. For not just me, but for her.
Correct. Yeah, man, and you observing you guys seem to be a close unit. So it's like a family thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. All right, moving on. Now that you have a Grammy nomination based on the album The Sly and Robbie Reggae for Her, what do you think does that mean to you as an artist and your brand?
I mean, it's the greatest thing that can happen, not just to me, but any artist. That's like the ultimate dream of anyone. That's like the ultimate dream, you know? So to be nominated, especially so young.
Yes.
I like the greatest feeling, man, trust me.
All right. Good, good, good. Like I said, I'm glad for you on that one, man. No respect. Congrats. Yeah. What comes to mind when you hear some say dancehall music or lyrics has somewhat of an impact on the society?
I would say it's 50-50. If it's not even 50-50, it would be solely on the persons who are listening. You know, we are doing music, it is art. A man is supposed to respect himself and know what he's capable of, know what he wants.
Right.
You know, so not just as a man sing about violence, you're supposed to understand and know that it's just art, basically. And if dancehall music is going to be blamed, also all the television movies that depict violence should be blamed as well and banned.
No.
But I don't think dancehall, it is but 50-50.
Okay, so you're saying you can't say that it doesn't, not 100%, but it have a percentage of it.
Yeah, because in my view, I don't really like the violent type of lyrics. If it was up to me, I would definitely make that cut out.
Right, right.
Yes, and that's where the 50 would come in, but I don't think it would depend on the person listening to music. As I said, they should be in control of their mind.
Most definitely, because I mean, you're an adult, you're responsible for your action. I'm 32 years old, and I grew up in the, you know, the Bounty Killer and the Beano Man clashes and stuff like that, and you know, I myself is guilty of listening and you know, dibble dabbling in the clash thing and the violent lyrics, so to speak. But I've lately, especially with what's going on in Jamaica with the crime and the violence and stuff, it's like I think I don't have the appetite really to really listen to too much of them gun tune too much anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
when I listen to the gun songs, it was fun.
Yeah.
When I won 95, you know, so at that time I never really sensible. So like in the early 2000s, my father now an old man, so you know, basically I grew up listening to all type of music.
Right, right.
I was listening to the Beano Man and the Bounty Killer clash and the Ninja Man clash. It was fun, even in the early 2000s when I was listening to some clash with either Elephant Man, the Man, Beano Man. All of them was in one tape performing the lyrical battle.
Right.
And if you look at the performance of the day, they are hug up and laughing from the stage.
Yeah.
When I'm Nathan and Dista Man, him take it and him laugh and pretend say him a ball on stage and the fans enjoy it at that time. But now, a man can't have a brush on a man.
I tell you, brother. I tell you, it's like the man them take it literal. Can't run them the joke again, it seems, these days. But, Devin, this is the last question I'm going to ask you. And, you know, we're boiling down to the bottom of it now. And it was a pleasure talking to you, man. What's next now for Devin as far as shows and music? I know you said that EP, but
as I said before, I'm working on the work permit so we can get some shows and start a lot of promotion in the US.
Mm-hmm.
I already have the US visa is up and ready. We have that, so as I said, just the work permit. So we can do shows and do some work in the U.S. Yeah, that's the main thing. And when it comes to promotion-wise, locally and everywhere else, we have the Reggae for Her, we have the song Ayo Ayo, which is the lead singer from that album, which was nominated for Grammy.
Right.
Yeah, so we're pushing that song. And then future projects, as I said, I have the I Am F. Coffrey EP. That's like a game changer to dancehall, especially because the tracks on it, trust me, that's something to really look out for.
Yeah, man, I will.
It has a EDM trap top flavor to it, but it's still dancehall. It's like I'm reinventing a new dancehall thing. You know, so I am head suffering. Let me call you that.
We'll be doing that, brother. We'll be doing that. Do you see yourself doing anything? Because talking to your brother, man, I tell you, it's like you kind of have your little joke, man. You ever think maybe going into acting or anything like that apart from music or just music?
Definitely, man. Once it is art, you know. Once it is art, even the doctor is always open. And me used to act back in high school days.
Me not surprised.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
All right, brother. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that was we're wrapping it up right now. As I said before, we are live with Devin, the doctor, and look out for him, man, because he is the present and the future of dancehall. And brother, I just hope that, you know, I wish you nothing but the best of success, and I hope they start to play, because I know that a lot of times there's a lot of politics with the selectors and stuff, with playing songs and stuff like that. But we need more artists like you, pumping the music, you know what I mean? So, you know, like I said, as I usually say, keep everything solid. Devin, it's a pleasure having you on the show, man. All right, stay tuned, ladies and gentlemen. Give thanks.
When me was a youth, me granny whipped me and me skinny could I catch a fire. Nearby Fred, turn a plane, a lynch park, and the music just blazes higher.